The Bucks took game four versus the Nets, and we now have a tied series. Kyrie Irving left the game in the second quarter with a right ankle injury, and KD was held to 9-for-25 from the field. Here's Steve Nash following the game.
Yeah, Kai, x-rays were negative, but we'll have to see how it goes tomorrow and further tests and treatment. We lost a great player during the game, which was tough. We all got to pitch in. We all got to play together. We got to move the ball. And I thought tonight we got a little single-minded, looking for Kevin every time. Puts a little bit too much pressure on him. It makes us a little more predictable, I thought, which puts a lot of burden on him.
And look who we have joining us, Roz Gold on Wude joining First Take. And Roz, you know, it's really sad because there is the real possibility now that both James Harden and Kyrie Irving will be out for game five. So do you think, Roz, that Durant can win a game without the rest of the big three?
Yes, I definitely think that it's possible for the Nets and Kevin Durant to win a game, win the series without Kyrie or without Harden. But, you know, I think one is going to take KD being great, but two, this is going to be a team-wide shift that's needed. First and foremost, this team has to be able to meet the Bucks' intensity, physicality, toughness. They were out-toughed by the Bucks in this game. The Bucks, starting with PJ Tucker, setting the tone, sacrificing his body, getting on the floor, getting in fights. He might have gotten away with some fouls too, but that's part of the game plan. Nobody's paying PJ Tucker to play pretty basketball. His job is literally to muck things up and hit corner threes, and he set that tone. So as a team, the Nets need to change their attitude and be tougher and more physical in the next game. And then the next thing I would say that's also important is going to be ball movement. If they're without Kyrie and Harden, they're without two top playmakers, guys that can create their own shots, create shots for others. So what's going to be key is ball movement, body movement. And all those role players, I don't want them out there just chucking up a bunch of shots in game five of the playoffs. I want them to work harder to create easier and better shots for each other. Movement without the ball, ball movement, playing in pace, beating a good physical Bucks defense down the court before they get a chance to be physical and set up with you, transition and some offense over defense, ball movement, attitude shift, and toughness. I think that's how they can do it.
And see, that's why I think it's a no. And Roz, I hear exactly what you're saying from that standpoint. I don't trust that they're going to be able to do that. And we're putting a lot of pressure on Kevin Durant for obvious reasons. This is what he wanted, to be a part of the Brooklyn Nets and have that kind of pressure. Think about this, ladies. This will be the most important game for Kevin Durant since Game 7 when he played for Oklahoma City against the Golden State Warriors when they had a 3-1 lead in that series. And in that game, he was terrific, but he was a playmaker but didn't have a lot of help. And the team that he had then is better than the guys he has right now without Kevin, without James Harden, and without Kyrie Irving. That's why it's really incumbent upon Steve Nash. Kevin Durant can't just start and facilitate things. Get him to where he's going to do the most damage. Get him on the low block, get him on isolations, and when they load up on him, you have to trust that guys will be able to make shots. I trust that Kevin Durant is going to be terrific. He's going to make a lot of plays for himself and try to make plays for other people. I just don't trust those guys that they'll be able to do that, and that's why I don't believe he can win another game in this series without James Harden and Kyrie Irving, because I trust Kevin Durant enough to make plays, but enough with other guys to raise their level and do that. That's why I don't think he'll be able to do it in this series against the Milwaukee Bucks.
Freddie, you don't trust these guys to move the basketball? I mean, let's not forget that the big three actually only play, what, 7 games together? We've said it all year round. They've been on the floor without their star power. I think Roz laid it out perfectly. Attitude adjustment and ball movement. To me, moving the basketball is quintessentially one of the simplest things to do in the game. And if you're asking me, can they execute an offense that includes some more motion so that ultimately it still ends up in the hands of Kevin Durant? I think that they can handle that. The idea that this team cannot step up to the occasion in terms of playing tougher, to me, Freddie, like that's wild, bro. Like, they can play tougher. There's another level to go. And all of a sudden, we're acting like this Milwaukee Bucks team has been steamrolling the Brooklyn Nets this entire series. They are not that far removed from looking like the gum on the bottom of your shoe when you're walking through New York City. And I just don't buy that they are suddenly that consistent, and there's no way for this Brooklyn Nets squad to match them in terms of toughness and something as simple as ball movement. I even think that they could bring the defensive intensity to support Kevin Durant. One game, Freddie? Roz said series. I don't know if I can get with series, but one game?
Here's to your point about one game. After game two, what were we saying about the Bucks when they lost by 39? People said they had no chance of winning the series. Mm-hmm. So we're going to use the one-game theory. Then we got to apply to both of these situations here. All of a sudden, you're trying to tell me that, okay, one game later, that the Brooklyn Nets are going to find their shooting stroke, and you're thinking that Landry Shamet, Joe Harris, who's been terrific, who's not been terrific in this series, other people are going to step up. That's asking a lot of those guys, because we have to remember the genius of Kyrie Irving and James Harden. You can overcome James Harden. You still have Kyrie Irving and Kevin Durant on your basketball team. But not having both of those guys and saying, hey, Kevin Durant, go out there and lead the way. And we got Mike Jones,
we've got Blake Griffin,
and all those guys.
We've been spoiled.
You can have all the
though.
Ball movement you want, but if guys aren't making shots, then it doesn't matter. And then you play right in the hands of Milwaukee Bucks. This
Come
is more
on,
about the Brooklyn Nets,
him.
Not the Milwaukee
Roz,
Bucks.
Talk to him about KD's greatness. Talk to him, Rob. Please talk to him.
Let me tag in, sis. Can I tag?
Yeah, please. You win. Go.
No, but Freddie, like, this is a team that has only seen KD, Kyrie, and Harden play 8 total games together this season. It's not like any of this is brain surgery or something brand new to them, suddenly having to step up and deliver. Without those big three even being on the court together, they still managed to be second in the East. You know, you bring up Joe Harris who has yet to find his stroke in this series. I think he's shooting just above 20% in this series. He's supposed to be one of the top 3-point shooters in the whole league. I think the types of shots that are being created are important, and how they're creating good and hunting for great shots is important. And I keep coming back to ball movement. Basketball is a simple team game. Mm-hmm. You look at the 2 wins that the Nets had. They were averaging like 27, 26 assists per game. And the 2 losses, they're way down around 17 assists. You know, so you're talking about a difference in play creation and also creating some offense off of defense, making the game easier for each other. And then to come back to defending Kevin Durant, when you look at the way they were running offense once Kyrie was out, Coach Nash said it himself, the team looked predictable. They were giving a rock to KD, and it kind of looked like, please make something happen, Kevin. And the problem is that the Bucks have personnel. First of all, PJ Tucker is physical on him. That's the first line of defense. The second line of defense is also big and long. Chris Middleton or Brooke Lopez waiting for him. There's so much size and physicality, working hard, all focused on KD. Almost all his shots were contested, hard, fouled. He was on the floor. He's getting yelled at. You know, Connaughton's bleeding. This is a physical matchup. So it's not only creating better shots for each other. And to your point, you're like, well, let's set up KD more. As great as KD is, you still got to help make the shots more in rhythm and easier for him as well.
Roz, I hear you, but you're not playing a regular season game. This is playoff pressure in a game 5 that's going to feel like a game 7. So based on what you and Monica are trying to convince me, and let me give you credit, you're not convincing me at all, but it's a nice try to both of you. In this situation, I expect Kevin Durant to be great. I expect Kevin Durant to get 35 and 40. But where's the other 20? Where's the other 15? Where's the other 18 going to come from? Were those guys that he has right now part of this basketball team in this series with that playoff pressure going into game 5, and I know they're playing at home, that is asking a lot of those guys. You guys are exactly right. You ladies are exactly right. Ball movement, creating better shots. But are we really trusting Blake Griffin to make those shots? Are we trusting Joe Harris?
One game, Freddie. That's the thing for me. One game.
Yeah, it's one game.
Blake Griffin hasn't made shots the whole series. So you can add that. He's made a couple of shots here and there.
You didn't say one person had the 18. You had to have 18. You said we got to come up with it.
Monica, he had a play yesterday where he is going to the rim. He sees Lopez, and he did a 180 to throw the ball back to somebody else, threw the ball out of bounds. If he's doing that and not trusting himself, also we're going to trust Blake Griffin to do that in the game 5? You can have that faith all you want. I'm not having that faith at all.
Blake Griffin has been full of surprises in this series.
Thank you,
we found out he can still jump. We found out he can still defend.
This is great news.
And we found he doesn't want to dunk on tall people getting to the rim, too. We found that out, too.
Okay, well, look, the Nets, Freddie. They're 9-6 when one member of the big three plays that since James Harden's debut with the team. Now, that being said, last night makes the first time within this postseason, also the regular season, that the Nets neglected to score 100 points in back-to-back games. So they definitely will have their work cut out for them, especially if KD is the only one on the floor of that big three. All right, Roz, thank you so much.
Thanks, Viv.
Always
so
appreciate
good to be
your insight.
Back.
Bye, Roz.
All right,
bye,
back
y'all.
To the gridiron we go. First Take continues, because wait till you hear what Travis Kelce said about the Browns. Does the Pro